If you want to learn how to measure and plot temperatures, build wireless radio controllers, use servos to drive tools, or build weird things like, I don't know, a thermal camera, here, you'll learn mechatronics in minutes. Last week, we learned how to save data to your MCU's non-volatile memory for things like settings and sensor calibration values. If you want to save data from telemetry systems, a GPS sensor, temperature sensors, the EEPROM will run out of space very quickly. It's time to learn how to use an SD card. Over the next few minutes, we'll learn how to wire an SD card, write data, plot some data in Excel, and read data from an SD card. SD card readers for your Teensy and Arduino come in different configurations. Standalone readers can support mini or micro SD cards, some are built into displays, and some are just a card reader for soldering directly to your PCB. In any case, cards operate on 3.3 volts, so a direct connection to your Teensy can be easily made. But 5-volt Arduinos need some special circuitry called level shifters. That's what these small chips are. Not all card readers use level shifters. Some displays use a series resistor to soak up the extra voltage. If you plan on using the display's card reader with a 3.3 volt device, make sure you place the resistor with a 0 ohm resistor. I've never seen an SD card or SD card reader that is not SPI based, so wiring is pretty standard for that bus. Per this wiring diagram, connect the card's MISO to the MCU's pin 12, MOSI to pin 11, SCK to pin 13. These pins are the standard SPI pins for most Teensys and Arduinos. Finally, connect the CS pin or chip select to pin 10. This chip select pin can be different, but make sure whatever pin you do use supports fast switching. As with any chip select, you may have to add a pull-up resistor to force the signal high when the SD card is not being accessed. A 10K value is a pretty common value. Remember, the SPI bus can be shared with multiple devices. This diagram shows the connectivity if you're using the card in conjunction with an SPI-based display. Notice how MISO, MOSI, and clock are shared, but each device gets its own chip select pin. Alright, quick look at the code. We'll include SPI.h, and I, like I said earlier, I'm going to use SDFAT.h. I've got a pin definition for my chip select pin. And I also have an optional SPI bus speed set to 50. Create your objects for SDFAT, that's the SD card itself, and then a file system, which I'm just going to call file. Serial.begin 115200, that's probably okay here. And the first line that you're going to have to call is SD.begin. This is going to initialize your SD card. There's my chip select, and this parameter is actually optional where I'm setting the bus speed to 50 megahertz. I believe the default on the SPI bus is 30 megahertz. If you're having problems with your SD card not working, you might bump that down to 30, even 20 to get the card to work. Mine happens to work with 50, so I'm going to make that thing go as fast as I can. If the SD card begin fails, let me know and just enter an infinite loop. If not, let me know that it was just fine and move on to the next line. And here's where we're going to open up a file and write some data to it. So the file object has a method called open. You pass in the file name, just example1.txt. This can be a char, and I highly recommend you make this a char in the future. That way you can change your file name through code and a few other neat things that I'll show you in the next example. Open this up for write or create, and if it works, great. If not, let me know. Then we're just going to simply use the print method on the file object for hello world. File print is just like serial print, but you're writing to the file object and not the serial monitor. Let me know, and of course, very important, make sure you close your file when you're all done. The convention that I typically do is I will open up a file, write to it, and close it right down, even if I'm writing one piece of data. I just find it's a little bit more reliable. If your MCU goes down, or you have problems, or whatever, you don't have an open file. SD card was okay, write was okay, and let's take a look at the results. And there you go, hello world, real simple example on how to write to your SD card. Now that the basics are working, let's monitor analog pin and write a bit value and its converted voltage. Consider this a very simple telemetry system. Ultimately, we want to analyze the data and plot trends and things in Excel. Fortunately, Excel has a neat input filter for reading data separated by commas. We'll write our telemetry data to a CSV format. This example is going to be a little bit longer here because I'm doing some neat things I'd like to point out. Just like before, include your libraries, pin numbers, all that kind of jazz. Here I'm putting my file name as a char, taking note of the first two characters being XX. I'm going to substitute that with the next available file number. And because I'm going to be searching files on the SD card, I'm going to create another file type called root so I can search the root folder for any file that meets that pattern. Like before, sd.begin, no changes here. Here I have a fancy build file name, and I'll cover that in just a minute. Because I'm running to a CSV file, I really want to have a header in there on what the first row is, defining the point, the volts, the amps, you know, speed, you know, whatever you happen to be writing to. Then in loop, we're going to call a function called logData, and if it worked, great. If not, go into an infinite loop to shut everything down. I'm only going to be logging about 50 points here just to get the point across, no pun intended. So build file name, this is kind of one of the things I do in a lot of my projects here is when I fire up an SD card, I go and find the highest file number with the CSV extension, add one to it, that becomes my new file name. So my extension mask is .csv, some buffer values and a few other neat things in here, last file number. I open up the root directory on my SD card, and I'm going to rip through that, getting all the files that meet that extension. And if the extension exists, go and increment, or at least get its file number. And if it's greater than the last file number, you make that the current file number. So basically, the first file number might be 1, then the next is 2. 2 is greater than 1, so last file becomes 2. Then the next file might be 17. 17 is greater than 2, so 17 becomes the number here. Now, the reason I'm doing this, and not just counting the number of CSV files, is just for that example, is if I happen to accidentally skip anything or I delete a file off my SD card, I'm not overriding existing data. I go get the biggest file number and write to it. So if you have 27 files on here and the last one is 99, your next one will be the next file number. So after we get the last file number, we close everything down and we increment that file number by 1, and then we are going to set that as its first two characters, whatever that number happens to be. Now, I can only go up to 99 files with this scheme here. If I really wanted to go up to 1,000 files, or I should say 999, I would just happen to have a second file numbering placeholder in here. And again, my naming convention is this xx.csv. If I want it up to 999, you would have an xxx.csv. Then when I do that, then I can return the file name if it exists, or I do another check to make sure that maybe something's screwed up and it's going to create it for us. Next thing I do is after I build the file is, where I lost my place here, is I'm going to write the header. This is one call done in setup, and I simply open up the file to that file name, that newly created file. I am going to print point, comma, bits, comma, volts. That's all I'm writing. That's a comma separated format just there. And this is why I like sd.fat.h is because you have the ability to create a timestamp and save that data with you. Now, I'm hard coding the year, the month, the date, and the hour, and all that. Normally, you would have an RTC clock hooked up and you would get that off of your system's clock and you'd have the actual date on here. But I don't have a clock. That's for another tutorial. Close the file. Again, this is the way I operate here from years of database programming is open a file, write the data, and then close the file right back down. Don't leave all these open files laying around. Then in the log data, as you can imagine, we open up the file. We go and we print the current seconds. We get the analog read in bits, and we print that to the file. And then we convert that bits to volts, and we write that to the file. Update the timestamp for the write, the last time you wrote to it, the access, close the file down. Now we're going to do that 50 times, and you'll see just here that after when I gets to 50, we're going to stop everything. I just don't need to write this thing till the end of time. And when we compile and upload that, you can actually see how it's going to increment and show me the record that it's currently writing in the serial monitor. Now once that's done, we'll bring up the CSV file, and you can see exactly what that looks like. And we'll kind of do two things at one time. You can kind of see the serial monitor happening in the background here. Now, I know I'm running to file 18. I'll show 17 here. I've already got this one opened up here. But you can see how we wrote point, bits, volts, and there's the data in the comma-separated format. Like I said, Excel knows what to do with this, so all you need to do is double-click that file, brings that up into Excel, and it puts everything in its own individual cell for you, so you can do math on it, you can do plotting on it, all kinds of neat things. Now, as the data stands, kind of boring. You really can't see anything or see any trends. Just highlight a cell, go to Insert, go to Line, and draw a 2D line, and it shows you exactly what the trend is of my bit reading and the voltage reading. Now, I put my thumb over the pin analog A0. I can't talk today. And you can see how I'm getting some kind of weird data there. Now, if you want to see the volts is so much lower than the bit value, just simply right-click and put this on its own axes just to kind of separate things across. Now, as you'd expect, there is a direct relationship between the bits and the volts because I've got a constant conversion between them. Anyway, that is how you can measure data, save it to an SD card, and a real quick example of how to plot this in Excel for looking at trends and things of that nature. Now that we can write data, what about reading data? This function does just that. I'll skip all the details of the code. Everything is exactly the same as the last example, except for my read data file function. First, I've got some characters for field names and the overall line. These are way bigger than they have to be, but I gave a little bit of extra room just in case. Give some variables for points that you want to read. Point, data points, unsigned long, I'll show you a little trick here in just a second, and line length. The general syntax that we're going to be doing, or the general workflow that we're going to be doing, we're going to be opening up a file, reading a line, and then using ssscanf to suck all the stuff out of that line and put it into its individual data fields. For integers, it's pretty easy. Just a percent %i followed by a comma, hint, hint. We're using a comma-separated file, so I'm going to have that in there so scanf knows where to put everything. You pass int data by a reference. If you're wanting to read characters out of a file, use this really goofy syntax right here. Basically, read data up until you get to a comma, then stop reading, giving yourselves 30 characters to read that data into. That data size needs to be the same as your field size up here. You're going to pass this into char data, but notice there's no reference or pass by reference. You can pass floats, or at least they say you can pass floats into scanf using Arduino, but you have to change some compiler options. The trick that I always do is I just multiply my int times 10,000 on save and then divide it by 10,000 coming out. That's usually going to be enough precision for me. Open the file, as you've seen me previously do. Get the line using fgets. Get the line length. If it has a end of line character in there, remove it. If the line length is zero, you're probably done reading data. Then I'm going to read the very first line and get the field names out of my comma-separated file. Remember, first line I wrote was the point, bits, and volts. So we're going to read that into an individual field and just display that on the screen. You could display the entire line if you want to. The only reason I'm doing this is so you can have an example on how to read character data out of a comma-separated file. Then read the next line, and then go and parse it, or not parse it, but then read the next line and process accordingly. Remove any end-of-line characters. Use scanf to dump all of your data into these integers, point, bits, and volts. Remember, volts is a supposed to be a float, but I'm simply multiplying it by 10,000 on the save and dividing it by 10,000 coming out. Then get the next line and continue on. You're going to do that until line length is zero. And if line length is zero, then you're going to bail out of the out of this function. And that's it. The results here are we've already logged the data to 28.csv, and there is the actual results in the serial monitor. The original file was just like such. So you can see how you have 0.0, and that is 538.2670. Now, if you're wondering why my point is 0, 0, 1, 1, 1, 1, all that, I actually changed my write times to 100 milliseconds just because I got sick of looking at this thing. But it would normally be in whatever data that you write. That's how you can write data to a CSV file and use this kind of a function here to get data out. Uses for reading data can be for restoring settings, restoring telemetry data on a power down. Reading and displaying images can also be done, but that's for a future tutorial. Over the last few minutes, I made it look easy getting an SD card to work, but it's not always this foolproof. The example that ships with the Arduino IDE show how to do some fancy stuff like create folders, list files, and other useful features. If you get stuck and you can't get your card working, try this. Make sure MISO is connected to pin 12 and MOSI is connected to pin 11. Make sure you have good connections between the card reader and the MCU and use good wires. Add a pull-up resistor to the chip select and use a fresh, fast, formatted SD card. Well, that covers this week's lesson. If you learned something, give me a thumbs up. If you have a tip to share, leave a comment so my subs can learn more. Thanks for watching.